fly the war-torn skies of Europe with Hitler's mighty Luftwaffe. At the dawn of the Second World War, the Ju-87 Stuka dive bomber symbolized the lightning speed of the Blitzkrieg attack. A revolution in a new type of aerial warfare, the Stuka reigned terror over unprepared armies, but finally met its match at the Battle of Britain. Tonight, fly with the elite airmen of the Third Reich on Wings of the Luftwaffe.
In detail, it was much like every other bomber aircraft of its day. Decidedly overbuilt, rugged to a fault, it was as much a product of propaganda as of accomplishment. Nevertheless, it was also highly effective at doing what it was designed to do, attacking and destroying ground targets, including personnel and equipment. In the hands of a competent pilot, it was a decidedly efficient weapon. This is one of the few remaining examples of the bent-wing Ju-87 Stuka. It survives at the Royal Air Force Museum in Hendon and is a testament to the Nazis' ability to produce specific purpose aircraft, like the dive bomber. Hardly an object of beauty, the Ju-87 was purpose-built for its role as a tank of the sky. And when it had sufficient protection, this was a mission it performed well, at least for the first part of the Second World War. Although from 1942 onwards, the type was clearly showing its age. Usually perceived as a weapon of the Luftwaffe, the Ju-87 was used by several other Axis air forces, as they all fought to capitalize on the new techniques of war developed in the 1930s. The central core of the new theory was the concept of Blitzkrieg, lightning attack by land supported with intensity from the air. Military theorists envisaged that large numbers of dive bombers, flying in packs, would blast a way through for ground troops, so that the speed of the tanks and armored carriers could be used simply to take the enemy by surprise. German preoccupation with ground attack aircraft did not begin during the pre-World War II 1930s. In fact, support for such military philosophies had its origins during World War I, as exemplified by this AEG bomber, being loaded here with 100 kilogram bombs for an attack against the Allies. World War I ground operations were the worst of all possible nightmares. The conditions were abysmal and attacks came from virtually all quarters with little respite from the air. The effectiveness of such air attacks proved a major revelation to combatants, as not only were they physically debilitating, but psychologically so as well. This lesson didn't go unheeded, and within months of the initial successes, all combatants were operating aircraft optimized for ground attack. The German Air Force was quick to extend its lead in this arena, and many bombers, such as this Gotha GV, were created to fill the ground attack role. The combat successes enjoyed by these aircraft set a precedent for all military airplanes to come. Attack from above, when conducted by surprise, was a most efficient and devastating means of delivering destructive firepower onto a target. If such attacks could be undertaken with even a modicum of accuracy, they could quickly debilitate their target at little or no cost to the attacker. Virtually all combatants, such as, for instance, Italy with their Caproni CA-3, rushed bomber aircraft into production before the cessation of hostilities. Consequent to the development of bombers, there was a newly aroused interest in the development of self-stabilized, free-falling iron bombs. And in an interim attempt to develop smaller, more maneuverable bombing platforms, the ground attack aircraft came to life in the form of such early technology exercises as the Royal Aircraft Factory FE-2. With the cessation of hostilities in 1918, the world's armament factory suddenly found their existence without justification. The aircraft industry and associated military air services were aware of this sagging enthusiasm. Aerial spectaculars, such as the first transatlantic crossing by fixed-wing aircraft with Alcock and Brown in the Vickers Vimy in 1919, were heartily endorsed because of their public relations value. Similarly, aerial displays such as this, with a multitude of Keystone LB-5 bombers making a formation flyby, were promoted unashamedly in the hope that public support would be forthcoming for the modern US air service. Bombs and bombers increased in perceived stature following the successful attack on the retired German battleship Ostfriesland by Lieutenant Colonel Billy Mitchell during July of 1921. There was now no denying the effect of aircraft on the future of military conflict. Bombs and other weapons delivered from the sky offered a virtually unstoppable means of attacking an enemy deep within his own borders. No target was invulnerable, be it a terrestrial structure of concrete or a steel-walled ship at sea. Mitchell's bombers and their undeniable successes had destroyed the myth of battleship invincibility, and likewise the invincibility of all other weapons of warfare. With the advent of the first US aircraft carrier, the Langley, the Navy issued a contract for dedicated carrier aircraft. From these designs, the Naval Aircraft Factory produced a series of successful biplanes. The emphasis was on the dive bombing mission, simply because this produced the most accurate results available at the time. From flying height, even large ships at sea became small targets. By the middle of 1920, a whole series of new biplane aircraft was being developed, and the Curtiss Company of North America was clearly showing the world a lead in producing not only fighters, but accurate dive bombers, which were suitable for carrier use, as defined by the United States Navy. As the decade came to an end, the biplane was still supreme as the single-engined aircraft, although some manufacturers were experimenting with the monoplane concept, an idea that was at odds with the conventions of the time. This proven sturdy biplane was one of the Hawk series produced by Curtiss and lent itself to the accurate dive bomber role. It impressed German World War I ace Ernst Udet to such an extent when he visited America that he arranged to purchase the model, which was sent back to Europe for analysis by German technicians. There is no doubt that Udet was smitten by the Hawk's performance. General Rabach explains.
I think he fell in love with the Curtiss biplane at this time, and he, as we were told, he got one as a gift from the American company, I think, and took it over, and this was our first Stuka.
Although the American Navy pioneered much of the dive bomber research, as time went by, it was to become more interested in other types of aerial attack on surface vessels. Horizontal bombing and the torpedo mission were also under development. And all these methods would require the skill of naval aviators landing on a small patch in the ocean. From data collected on the Hawk, the enthusiastic Udet commissioned German refinements under his responsibility for developing aircraft for the new German Air Force. Under the patronage of Göring, his views were quickly adopted, and soon German production of their own dive bomber became a matter of priority.
Udet was he should have become general or a military person, because he was the lucky pilot at all, and a very, very good pilot. If you remember the echoes he did, acrobatics. It was very impressive when he took a handkerchief up with the wing tip.
Certainly, Udet's passion for agile aircraft was reflected in Germany's first dive bomber, the Henschel 123. Effective and durable, the model was considered to be one of the best of its kind. The Arado 95 was another similar plane of the era. Although it flew somewhat later than the Henschel aircraft, it still typified some of the basic features: a large radial engine and fixed undercarriage streamlined by spats. It too had considerable agility and was said to have been very easy to fly, but it was never adopted as a land-based aircraft. However, it did see limited service as a seaplane operating from large German warships. In the end, the land-based version was sold abroad, although surely it must have been considered for its dive bombing potential in Europe. By the autumn of 1935, the new German Luftwaffe was developing its first monoplane dive bomber. Perceived as a replacement for the 123, the first prototype Ju-87 Stuka was considered a strong hope for the future. Early production began in 1936, though the numbers were limited as the model still required some development, apart from improvements to design and techniques of manufacture. The first Ju-87s were powered by a Rolls-Royce Kestrel engine, there being no better type available of German manufacture. Later, all the production models were powered by Jumo inline engines produced by the 87's manufacturers, Junkers. Over the life of the 87's airframe, its horsepower increased from 600 to 1400. There would also be a learning curve for Luftwaffe pilots to develop new strategies in using this latest type of warplane. The diving attack position would require special skills not previously demanded of aircrew. A great deal of information would have to be gained about flying in attack formations to maximize the 87's hitting power. The Stuka carried one main bomb, and a window was provided so that the pilot could see that it was lowered by a trapeze to clear the propeller's arc before launching. This was peculiar to dive bombers. The 87's cranked wing provided the considerable lift needed by dive bombers, but also assisted the fixed undercarriage by ensuring the propeller was well clear of the ground on takeoff. Large trailing edge flaps, typical of most Junkers models of the time, helped to stabilize the aircraft, especially in the dive mode. They were counterbalanced by weights to reduce pilot effort, since no power assistance was available for aircraft of this type. They ran the entire length of the wing. The Stuka's wing had to be exceptionally strong, first to bear the stress of the aircraft as it pulled out of a screaming dive, and then as the foundation to the fixed undercarriage, where it had to absorb some of the impact of landing. Overall, the Ju-87s were never given the higher level of finish used on fighter aircraft. The rationale was simple. Its mission only required that it operate at relatively low speeds. Therefore, no attempt was made to reduce protrusions, such as these primitive struts and supports with which it was adorned. Even the undercarriage was as basic a device as possible. Leather booting was their only protection against the elements. And the rivets that festooned the wing were never flush with the surface as they would be with a potentially faster aircraft. The other benefit of pragmatism was service in the field. Given the various battlefronts in which it would have to fight, it was important that the aircraft be easily repaired and adaptable to improvisation. There were clever points too. If one wheel strut had been shot away, the remaining gear would make safe landing impossible.